Welcome, Mircea Cărtărescu, to Barcelona and to knowledge you. Thank you for being here. And well, my first question is it's very direct for Levantur. This novel is now published in Spanish by Editorial Impedimenta, and I read. Very fascinated this novel, and when I end the reading, if I was a dictator, I'm sure I forgive this novel, because I forbid this novel. Sorry. Because you are asking always for freedom, and this novel in your country, in Romania, was published after some years you entered the writing.
Yes, you are right. First, I want to thank you, for inviting me. I'm always felt at home in Spain, in Catalonia, and mainly in Barcelona. It's a wonderful city, and a very, very cultural one. And asking your question, I would start by saying that between I was 20 and till I got in my third decade of life, I had written and partially published six books of poetry, six big books of poetry. So at a certain moment, I felt it was enough. I got sick and tired with poetry, with the normal poetry that you see it published mostly everywhere. So I don't know, modernist, experimental, a bit Dadaist, a bit surrealist poetry. So at a certain moment, I felt that it was enough. And I started to wonder what should I write to surprise my readers and the critics and especially my friends, because I have always written for my friends mainly. And by that time, I was very interested in postmodernism. Postmodernism was quite a new thing for the Romanian writers, and as a professor at the university, I wrote a thesis about postmodernism, and I was in a way full of the novelty of this idea, which consisted partially in recycling the old styles, the old shapes that the literature could take during the in the past times, during the Baroque, for example, during the Mannerism in the 17th, in the 18th century, and so on. So at a certain moment, I felt the need to write in another language, and in another way of perceiving literature. So I started to write in the old manner, in the manner of some Romanian, and not only Romanian, writers who lived in the 19th or even 18th century. I felt that it was a charm, and it was a sort of a nostalgia in recovering the past, and recovering a way of maybe a naive way of feeling literature. And I started to write a long poem, having as a model Childe Harold by Byron. I started to write a very long poem that has the Mediterranean Sea as a background. This was my first and most important idea, the wonderful light of the Mediterranean Sea, which you have here in Barcelona too, but I was interested mainly in the eastern part of this sea, in the Greek archipelago, and places that we know under the name of the El Levante, the Levant. So I had this idea that I will write about adventures on the sea in the most naive, but at the same time, on another level, sophisticated way. So it wasn't only that fresh, crisp naivete of the old writers, but it was a reflection on it, a literary and theoretical and cultural reflection on that genuine way of making literature. So I started to write an epic poem, which had to be in 12 cantos, like any epopee, like Homer's epopees, for example, or Virgil's epopee. But I started to write without any plan. So I had nothing in my mind when I started to write it. And actually, to be sincere with you, I didn't think that I will ever finish it. So it was a joke for me. It was just a literary play, in a way. But by and by, I started to have trust in this project, and I started to enjoy it very much, because I it was not only the old forms of literature that I was recycling, but even the Romanian language. The book initially is written in the old Romanian language, which was the matter of some old poets we had. Those old poets are at the same time sublime and ridiculous, because the language is so funny, so strange, so sounds so bizarre in your ears, that it's at the same time ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. You start laughing at those poets. They are absolutely kitsch and ridiculous and so on, but at the same time, because they are naive and they really enjoy writing literature, they are sublime, they are wonderful. So I started to write in that language, which I know because it's the dialect of my mother. My mother was a simple peasant, and she was speaking that dialect, that ridiculous dialect, with accepted no norm of the civilized literary Romanian language. And I started writing that language, and I felt it was in a way written in my DNA, written in my DNA. It was so natural for me to use it. You can imagine some Spanish writer who writes in Catalan, or some a Spanish writer who writes in the language spoken in Argentina, mm-hmm. for example. It was pretty much the same. So I used this language, which is very, very nice and beautiful for the Romanian ears, and I started to invent adventures and to invent characters and to get a lot of joy from it. I really invented step by step a whole world, the world of this Levante, mm-hmm. with the pirates, with love stories, with philosophical adventures, with theological adventures, and so on. So up to the end, it was a sort of a perfect sphere that ended the same way it started, and so on. Having a multiple significance, I would say. It can be read even by a child. A child can have the pleasure to see adventures. An adolescent the same. But it can be read by refined readers who can find in it not only very many literary forms that are not used anymore, but at the same time, who can find a political meaning in it. Mm. Because you are very right when you said that actually this poem is a hymn addressed to the liberty. It's liberty, the freedom, is the most important theme, the most important topic in this book, And in my mind, the freedom is the same thing with poetry. Poetry is the freedom itself in my mind. But because I wrote that book in 88 and 89, just before the Romanian Revolution and the fall of the Berlin Wall, for me it was a question of life and death to write about freedom. Because we had a tyrant, we had Ceausescu, as you know, and we lived in a prison by that time. So I had no hope that this poem will ever be published. I just wrote it for my friends. And it's not only a hymn to liberté, to the freedom, but also a very harsh satire against tyranny. Up to the end, it was about book is about a revolution which overthrows a tyrant, the prince that rules Wallachia by that time. So everybody, all my friends that I gave the manuscript to read, started to laugh because they recognized the situation and they knew that it was a poem against the dictatorship. So I couldn't publish it till the revolution.
But did you broke the manuscript to the publisher?
No, never. It would have been a big mistake.
At the same time, when you finish the poem, you make a pensi una cosa che è molto interessante about the power, that is the Gattopardian fact, no? Manoil and all the group make a real revolution, but at the end is cambiare tutto affinché nulla cambi.
Yes, it's a pessimistic ending, but I think it's realistic too, because what happened in Romania is more or less the same thing actually. Not the democratic people took the power in Romania, but almost the same dictatorial people that ruled before, they ruled after the revolution too, and they still rule Romania, in my opinion, today. So they were the communist apparatchiks and the securitate people, the secret police people, that after the revolution became the most important politicians, the most important financial people, the most important people who had business, who had the industrial economy in their hands, who had the most important media, newspapers, and so on. They are still the same.
It's so pessimistic but realistic.
But realistic.
Because not only in Romania.
Yeah.
When you talk about the freedom.
Yes, you might have experienced the same thing after Franco died. So you might have been very amazed that mostly the same people were still in power after that. And this happens all the time.
Mm-hmm. But the end of Levante è molto simbolico, mm-hmm. perché il poema ha un punto di vista romantico, mm-hmm. e se tu fossi stato un autore romantico, mm-hmm. Of the 19th century, probabilmente la fine sarebbe stata di pura libertà, mm-hmm. non in un senso gattopardiano, no? Mm-hmm. And I say that because I think that the most important thing of the book, in my point of view, mm-hmm. is that you try all the time to desacralize the solemnity of mm-hmm. poetry, mm-hmm. and you try to ironize about the fact that normally poetry is so sublime, so elevated, and really poetry must walk and must non so come si chiama in inglese, sporcarsi, mm-hmm. sporcarsi, mm-hmm. and touch the earth, not the sky. Mm-hmm.
Yes, you are very right. That's why actually I wrote this big poem. I should say that The Levant is a big satire and a revolt against a certain cultural system, not only a certain political system. It's a revolt against the typical poetry of our age.
Yeah.
The typical poetry of our age. This is very important for me. You are also right when you said you found in it a romantic root.
Yeah.
I used very very many postmodern features here. So I used the mingle of all periods and all epochs, anachronisms, anachronic words and anachronic things. I for example, I speak of napalm, in the
or Gramsci or
the 18th century and many many other references, Heisenberg, Gramsci and so on. But if you think to the depth of this poem, you will find there a neo-romantic vision on poetry and on the world. You are very right. Yes,
and it's very interesting because you say when I start writing this novel, it was not a novel. It was a joke. It was a play.
Yeah.
And in Levante there are adventures,
mm-hmm.
but there are, as you say, many references,
mm-hmm.
Cultural references, not only of the Mediterranean.
Yes.
Because I know you are very fan mm-hmm. Of the Latin American writers.
Yeah.
You said I read once
and Spanish that, writers. Yeah.
Yeah, and Spanish writers. I read once that you said that Romania it's in a wrong continent.
Yeah.
The Latin American Europe.
Yeah, we think sometimes we think of Romania like a country that got lost actually in Europe, a Latin American country that got lost in Europe, because we are so similar with mm-hmm. them, so similar. We had our dictatorship. We have this political and social unrest all the time, this corruption that is very characteristic for our country and so on. But the writers have another, let's say, South American feature, the imagination.
Yeah.
The Romanian writers are really very imaginative. Most of them are magical realists, like mm-hmm. Marquez, like everyone in South America. But I wanted to stress what you said for the first time about the references. First, I would say that this book is completely built on references. It's completely allusive. And this system just fell at the translation. So the book lost about, in my opinion, half of its significance by being translated. It's absolutely inevitable. No matter how good was the translator, because each and every verse alludes in my book to some other verses, other novels, other short stories in the Romanian literature that the people here doesn't know. So each and every verse, this is the charm of this poem, actually. The Romanians laugh all the time or are impressed all the time and at each verse because they recognize an allusion, an ironical allusion to Bolintinanu, to Alexandri, to a lot of Romanian writers that nobody know outside of Romania. But in my country, everybody knows them by heart. So this is lost. This is lost for good, and I had hope to have this part of the poem. Then there's another loss, a very very important loss. The poem was written in verses, so I thought for many years I thought that this book will be absolutely untranslatable. I had no hopes to be translated abroad. But at a certain moment, 2 years ago, I had this idea that I had to give a chance, at least a chance, to this book, and I rewrote it in prose. I spent some 3 months or 4 months to change everything into prose. So I, in a way, I betrayed a part of the book just for giving it the chance of being translated. So it's not the original that I gave to my translators all over Europe, mm-hmm. but this prose variant, which I made myself, and after I did it, I spread it to my translators and publishers. And Enrique was the first. He was very fast, and he did the first version. The Spanish version mm-hmm. is absolutely the first. And in the meantime, the French one has been published with POL in Paris. And this year, Albert Bonnier in Sweden mm-hmm. will do the Swedish mm-hmm. version. And next year, we will have the German one. And I hope there will be more.
About the elusive thing and about the transformation thing, mm-hmm. I think that these two aspects mm-hmm. shows another thing that is very important. Normally, in an epopee, mm-hmm. We think every time about gods, and in Levante, mm-hmm. you play about the fact, because, for example, Manoil and all the group... saw an eye yeah. in a certain moment, but the eye are you.
Yes. Yes.
At the same time, you write, I write this book, but really, mm-hmm. I write this book writing about myself. Mm-hmm. It's a book about a lot of things, but at the same time, it's a book about you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's another distinctive feature of postmodernism, the self-referentiality,
yeah.
the auto-referentiality. You know, each really postmodern book turns on itself and meditates on its own or includes the criticism of its own body. This book is, in a way, an immanent one. It contains everything, including its author and mm-hmm. its reader inside. So the author himself and the reader himself or herself are actually characters of this
book. Why the reader is a feminine reader?
you know what? There are two types of reading, of lecture. Male type and the female type of reading. The male type is confrontational. I don't mean that only the males are confrontational, but I call them in a way, in a general way, masculine and feminine. So the masculine type of reading is aggressive and confrontational. You don't believe the writer, the author. You feel the need to punch him and to quarrel with him, to talk back to him. While the feminine reading is comprehensive, is loving, is believing. You feel the need to believe the writer and to follow him. I always preferred this second kind of reading. I always preferred to exercise my magic towards the readers, to make them believe, to make them believe what I write, not to to talk with them in a let's say violent or confrontational way. That's why my reader is always represented by a young lady or by a woman and so on.
Well, we would
talk with you about the territory during hours and hours, but it's okay. Not possible. Mm-hmm. But to end the interview, I would like if you can read some poem that you have. I don't know if you have the poem about Natalie Wood. it's my preferred, but it doesn't matter. It can be.
But I prefer to read the poem which is included here.
Okay.
I didn't read last night in Madrid because there was it was too much.
Okay.
It was too much, and sometimes less is more. You know. So I could read it now. It's a smaller poem.
It's gonna be fantastic.
Okay. But I need my glasses, unfortunately. It is called Lasciami anima tua, so let me in your heart. It's talking about allusions, literary allusions. It's Let Me Into Your Heart is a famous song by George Harrison.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And Bob Dylan. Lasă-mă în inima ta, vară galbenă și fierbinte, tricou nu mai suge sudoarea, e fleașcă. Aștept troleul sau pe 21 ce vine, la teiul doamnei, stau în umbra firava unui copac, blugii sunt mai întunecați unde s-au atinte picior, îmbibați de transpirație. Îmi iarte spatele de urina asta care înțâșnește din pori, redonesc ceva, mă uit la mașinile care trec. Vine troleu, roșu și prăpuit, femei cu boabe de sudoare pe buza de sus, se înghesuie, niște șmecherași urcă și ei, și hardughia se urnește. Stau în față, mă uit prin oglinda retrovizoare, compostez, la 12 o să fiu în centru, e bine. Mă uit în jur, grăsane, mustăcioși, tip și tipe. Unul are în mână o cutie mare de ceai chinezesc, marca Dragon. Pe tricoul altuia scrie, After my wife ran away with my best friend, I realized how much I missed him. Și pe al meu scrie ceva, și anume Struggles Company 61 Holden Building CX 39170. Lângă mine se află firește o fată, altfel de ce aș fi scris poemul ăsta? O blondă, 17 ani, 18. Blondă, blondă, nu din cele brune la rădăcina părului, blondă ca în reclamele L'Oreal, cu o figură deloc vulgară, nici sofisticată, cam simpluță și totuși nu prea. Poate fi senzual, ceva foarte pur? Dacă da, ea avea acea senzualitate. M-am oprit din fredonat și mi-a stat inima, fiindcă bluza albă a fetei avea o croială prea largă la subțiori și prin panta de umbră ușor portocalie se vedea semiluna albă a coastei și sânul din profil. În vârf cu bănuțul la rămiu, tumefiat, fără sfârc, ca un bătișor de animal. Ea se ținea de vara de sus și pielea subțiori era moale, rasă de curând, și toată acea porțiune de câțiva centimetri pătrați de piele era... Nu mi-am imaginat ca de obicei cum ar putea face dragoste. Am respirat acolo, lângă brațul ei gol și umed, lângă coasta și sânul ei cu vârful grena. N-am fost excitat, ci... A întors capul și a citit instinctiv ce scria pe tricoul meu. M-am uitat în altă parte, la tipul cu cutia de ceai. Pe geam se perindau magazinele de pe moșilor, urma să schimb la bulevard, să iau alt troleibuz până la Cogălnicianu. M-am uitat la ceasul electronic al unuia, 11:46, și iar la brațul și sânul fetei. Și emoția aceea nu poți găsi citindu-l pe Brumaru sau poemul ăsta. Deodată a sărit un troleu, bum bum, pe acoperiș, și țărâitul din cabina șoferului. A trebuit să coborâm cu toții. M-am dat jos cu nasul între omoplații tipului solid cu After my wife ran away, etc., etc., cam în dreptul părinților lui Bogdan. M-am uitat după micuța blondă care se îndepărta grăbită, pierzându-se în mulțime. M-am pierdut și eu în mulțime, reluând între donatul. Era, firește, Harrison. Let me in here, you know I've been here, let me into your heart.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It was very nice.